Hello and welcome to another episode of Hollywood Wargaming's How to Build Box Sets for Bolt Action, and today we are going to be looking at how to build your Soviet infantry boxes. And of course, this is going to be referring to the Soviet infantry boxes from Warlord Games. And as far as the Soviet faction goes, we actually have some pretty interesting options here. First of all, the Soviets pretty much kept similar equipment throughout the war. Leading up to the Second World War, Stalin initiated his five-year plan, which was to industrialize the Soviet Union and bring their military up to date. However, with the German blitzkrieg of Soviet Russia and Operation Barbarossa, Soviet industry more or less ceased to advance. Now, it didn't stop, but the Soviets prioritized budgets and mass production. And that meant relocating a lot of machines, factories, and people who worked in the factories to produce the same amount of equipment with existing materials and machinery. So while tactics and doctrine may have changed throughout the war, Soviet infantry in the beginning of World War II weren't dramatically different from Soviet infantry at the end of World War II, at least in the terms that we're concerned with tabletop wargaming and 28mm models. And really, that is very advantageous for us because we can build a Soviet faction, and with the exception of a few pieces of equipment or maybe a few units, and of course perhaps how you base them being winter or summer seasons, your models can pretty much serve in any campaign book that involves the Soviets. Now, the Soviets are also very famous for their manpower in World War II. They were a very large agrarian nation, and very notorious for having an overwhelming amount of manpower they could draw from to mass conscript their population and pad out their forces. And that is reflected in bolt action, because while most other infantry sprues in the game come with only 6 models per sprue, usually having 5 sprues per box, meaning 30 models per box you buy, the Soviets have 8 models on every sprue, meaning a box of Soviet infantry is going to net you 40 infantry models. And that is a very, very good advantage to have, especially when you look at the Soviet Union rules and realize that they have a lot of diverse infantry options and a lot of extra slots in their reinforced platoon where you can fit more infantry into. So with 10 extra models per box, you're obviously going to be getting a lot more bang for your buck from these kits. But I will note that these kits are a little bit older and do follow the old school warlord style of having loose hands with the rifles and other weapons on their own sprue aside, meaning you will have to equip the weapons into each hand, which can be quite tedious for new modelers and doesn't always really look top notch, but it does allow for a little bit more flexibility in some ways. And when you take a good look at that Soviet weapon sprue, you're going to notice that there is a little bit more room for options there, meaning when we look at our potential support builds, you will be able to get a little bit more creative with the Soviet faction and build some special weapons that other units don't really have access to. But as always, this video is going to be broken down into 2 parts, the first being if you want to get a box set and just build basic infantry and pick up support squads and command squads separately. Again, Warlord does always sell blister packs for most major factions that include command squads, officers, support weapons, and things like that. But in many situations, you can also build those in the plastic kits. So it's really up to you. If you want this box set to serve as a sort of core infantry backbone that you're going to build on top of, go with the basic infantry build, the first build we're going to look at. But if you're getting into this hobby on a budget, or if you just want all plastic models and don't want to deal with any of the metal blister packs, stick around for some of the support option builds that we're going to look at in the second slide. But if you want to run that big Soviet horde with lots of infantry, I'll have you take a look at this basic infantry build here. And first up, you're going to notice a lot of rifles. Now those are of course the Mosin-Nagants, the famous Soviet rifle that people still covet today. And riflemen come cheap in bolt action, so if you really want to beef out your numbers, you're going to want a lot of riflemen. But that goes doubly so for the Soviets, because in every Soviet list, you are going to be getting a free rifleman squad. That of course is due to their quantity, it has a quality of its own national characteristic, and it is one that you are always going to be taking advantage of. There's no reason not to. However, it is worth noting that most Soviet squads, including this free squad, can take up to 12 men, and I do just have 10 rifles listed here. And really, that's because there's no way to evenly divide it up between four squads of 12 men in a 40-man box. And really, these videos aren't telling you how to run these squads, I'm just recommending how you build your infantry so you can mix and match them to your list building needs when the time comes. I'm not necessarily saying run these squads on the screen exactly, but rather, if you build your models in this manner, you are going to have the tools in your toolbox to build the list that you need. And honestly, if every infantry box set had 40 men instead of 30, I would probably say just build 10 extra riflemen every single time. It's very useful to have extra riflemen on hand, as you can just swap them out and save points in many different scenarios. It wasn't very long after I bought my first Africa Corps set and made an entire 12-man squad of submachine guns where I realized I needed to get another box and build a lot more riflemen. But after that, for our regular squads, we are going to have a little bit more equipment on them, and this is going to look pretty similar to our basic infantry build that I always recommend, where you have the NCO with a submachine gun, followed up by one LMG and a loader, and seven more regular riflemen. However, this time around, I'm going to say that we are going to go with just six regular riflemen and then one extra submachine gunner. So each squad is essentially going to have their NCO with a submachine gun, followed up by an assistant squad leader with a submachine gun, followed by that light machine gun and its loader, which for the Soviets is going to be the DP-27, and then six regular riflemen on top of that. And that's because with all these extra rifleman bodies, we can't afford to make three extra submachine gunners, who we can use in veteran squads, or even as their own command squad if you want, just because we are going to have the bodies on hand. It's just a nice luxury that you're going to be able to have with these extra bodies on every sprue. Now, let's talk weapons for a little bit. The PPSHs, which are the submachine guns, do come in two variants. Some of them have the banana clip magazine, others do have the drum magazine. They're both submachine guns. It doesn't matter which one you equip. And the same goes for the SVT rifles and the Mosin Nagants. The Mosin is going to be the longer bolt-action rifle with the pointier bayonets, while the SVT is going to have the more modern underslung bayonets and a magazine beneath it. While it was a semi-automatic rifle in real life, while the Mosin was a bolt-action, they are both representative of riflemen in this game, so it does not matter which one you equip them with. But if you are going for an early war Soviet faction, maybe avoid the SVTs. Soviets were also known in their desperate supply shortage that they often encountered throughout the war to take a lot of German equipment left behind, so they are ripe for kitbashing opportunities to give them equipment such as MP40s or MG34s, so long as the weapon matched that basic rifle, SMG, or LMG profile. But let's say you get this box set and you don't want to buy a metal command squad and you want to have some list diversity right out of the box with these 40 models. And that's going to move us along to our next squad build overview for support squads. And right away, you're going to see a much more crowded screen than we've seen on previous videos. But hey, that's pretty neat because we have a lot of options here. Soviets really do get to make use of their infantry in ways that other factions can't. And here, I think I have a more flexible guide on how to do that. So first of all, on the left here, we're going to see two similar squads to the ones I recommended previously. However, both are going to be 12-man builds, the first being that full conscript squad with just 12 solid riflemen. Again, this is just a very solid backbone to the Soviet faction, and honestly, infantry as a whole in bolt action. And next, we are going to see that 12-man version of the upgraded squad, and basically here, you're just going to be adding an extra LMG and an extra rifleman slash loader. Again, I'm not necessarily saying that you should be running a squad with two LMGs in it, but building two LMG guys is going to be advantageous should you want to field an LMG member in both of these 12-man squads. Also, keep in mind you can always take an LMG and two loaders next to him and just run him as an MMG team. It's perfectly acceptable, so long as you maintain the proper firing arcs and let your opponent know ahead of time what you're doing. But jumping across the screen to the bottom right, we are going to have your command squad. As always, command squads get free weapon upgrades, so take the submachine guns here. They really do increase the firepower of this unit, and you could always run your command squad as a two-man squad to give them that small team special rule, and then you'll have an extra submachine gunner to put in maybe a veteran squad. but having submachine guns really does up the efficiency of these guys, and there's no reason not to take it for free. As always, I am going to throw in my revolver disclaimer. It's always very cool to have an officer or a commissar waving their pistol in the air like that iconic Soviet picture. And if you really want to model that, you can always do it and then tell your opponents you're running him with a submachine gun or perhaps throw a submachine gun on his back. Basically, my point being, model him with a pistol if you want, but always run him with a submachine gun and let your opponents know that you're doing that. But after that, we're not only going to have the luxury of being able to make a sniper team, but also an anti-tank rifle team. And Soviets do get extra anti-tank slots in their reinforced platoon. And as I mentioned earlier in my early to mid-war German video, anti-tank rifles are not to be underestimated. They're no hard anti-armor counter, but they can be a serious threat to transports and other light vehicles, and greatly help pad out your activations at just 35 points per unit. And while snipers themselves aren't nearly as cheap, they can also be quite effective on the battlefield, and I know a lot of players who really like to run snipers. But the real beauty of having these two small units is their flexibility. Both of them are going to have a quote-unquote loader or spotter with them, which I like to model with binoculars, who can also be used as spotters for mortars, artillery observers, or forward air observers. Alternatively, you could always just give them a rifle and use them as riflemen should you want to pad out your infantry squads. For things like this, I really like to build a rifleman holding a pair of binoculars who can be used as a spotter, a loader, a NCO, or many other things should they need to be. It's a very easy way to get a lot of utility out of just one model. So using just four of your 40 models to build the sniper and anti-tank rifle team is a fantastic use of plastic that is not only appropriate for every period of the war, but is greatly going to add to your list building arsenal. And lastly, we are going to have the three-man group, and these are basically going to be your anti-tank squads, although not really. So when you look at the Soviet reinforced platoon, they are allowed to take anti-tank squads that are three men who can take upgrades like submachine guns and Panzerfaust. And while this unit itself might vary in practicality or effectiveness on the battlefield, as far as a modeling and building perspective goes, they're going to have a lot of utility when it comes to how you can use those models. Think of these guys like the miscellaneous leftover infantry on the bottom right screen of my other videos. You will have extra riflemen, extra submachine guns, and even Panzerfaust to throw in your units should you want to field a unit that needs them. Now, Panzerfaust are something that we have not discussed yet in any of these videos, but they are a sort of auxiliary one-trick weapon, and they can often be modeled as either an accessory or a primary weapon. And there are advantages to both of these options. If you model it as a primary weapon and don't have any other weapons on the model, you can have them slot into different units and say they are equipped with any weapon of your choice, be it submachine gun, assault rifle, or rifle. That's something that's very good for late war German grenadiers who have a lot of arsenal options, and you aren't going to be limiting yourself by saying, oh, here's my grenadier with a Panzerfaust, but he also has an assault rifle, and now I need to model one with a submachine gun, so everything's WYSIWYG. However, on the flip side of the coin, if you do build an infantry model with Panzerfaust as an accessory, such as a rifleman with a Panzerfaust thrown over his back, you can always just say that he's a rifleman and that this squad is not fielding any Panzerfaust. And for the Soviets who don't really get Panzerfaust in a lot of units, and really don't have that many equipment options in most of their units, I think that is actually the better move here. So for the Soviets, I would actually model these Panzerfaust as accessories on their rucks or slung over their shoulders or carrying them on their sides, alongside a standard rifle. That way, if you want to use them as just riflemen in a regular rifle unit, you can do so. But if you want them to represent a Panzerfaust-wielding unit such as a Guards unit or perhaps a Tank Hunter squad, they can stand in for that. It's a bit of a tricky technique when you're building your models, but it can allow for versatility if you do it right. Just make sure your opponents always know what units in your army have Panzerfaust and which ones do not. Also, Panzerfaust didn't really show up until late 1943, so if you are playing an early Soviet army and you don't want to do late war equipment, perhaps go with extra PTRD rifles or even DP-27 light machine guns. So, long story short, these last three three-man squads are a flexible nine models that you can use for various positions within your Soviet list, which again is very accommodating to diverse infantry units. However, with these last nine models, I would say don't build more than three LMGs or submachine guns or Panzerfausts, and make sure you're building at least three of them as extra riflemen. Remember, infantry is the core to every bolt action list, and that goes doubly so for the humble riflemen, and you really want to make sure you have enough of those basic riflemen to flesh out your core force, especially when you're playing the Horde Army of the Soviet Union. So just keep that in mind when you're building your box set, and I'll be honest, if you build just 40 riflemen, you haven't built your Soviets wrong. But let me know what you guys think in the comments down below. I'm actually not a Soviet player, so if you are a Soviet player, please leave your input, please leave your experiences with how to build and field Soviet infantry, and let me know how accurate you think I am with these recommendations, or if you would have any adjustments to them. As always, explain your reasoning. And if you guys liked this video, go ahead, leave a like, subscribe to the channel, consider turning on notifications to see more adjustments like this. These videos are relatively quick for me to make, and I do plan on cranking them out as the weeks go by. So stay tuned on these guides. It's a question I see pop up a lot on the forums, and I really want to be a community resource here, and all of your feedback onto this video contributes to the community and what I'm trying to build here, and it's all very much appreciated, as long as it's constructive, of course. But as always, guys, until next time, take care.